Bond, my guy, you're an easy top three, but like, you couldn't have used your powers a little bit more. Before we hop into this discussion on the wasted potential of Bond as a fighter, please do me a favor and leave your own thoughts on Bond's fighting skills in the comment section down below. Leave a like and subscribe if you haven't already. Also, hit that little notification bell so you don't miss out on any videos that come to the channel. Now, let's get into it. What's up, guys? Uncle the Pencil here, and here we are to talk about Bond and my man's wasted potential when it comes to him as a warrior. Specifically, the fact that I understand what Nakamura is going for with Bond's arc, but at the same time, I don't think it was worth the payout. Now, Bond is a character who was notoriously weak. Notoriously, unbelievably weak for the longest time of the series. He was super relevant during season one, had so many cool abilities, was constantly using them, was showing off, flexing, doing his good do, but then he sort of just got reduced to the Immortal Man around the time of the mid-series, where he was just like, oh yeah, he can't die, that's about it. And then after that, he got reduced to the not even Immortal Man. He's got reduced to the I hit you hard man. And to be fair, there are a lot of I hit you hard mans in Seven Deadly Sins, in anime in general. But the thing about Bond is, like, he had such a cool ability to start with that could have been so useful in so many different contexts, even while he was weaker. Snatch in of itself is such a useful ability for what it could do, simply as a redirection tool, something to get things away, or to weaken an opponent so your other more powerful fellow sins could do something. The thing is, I understand why Nakaba, like, hard nerfed Bond, both pre and post his power-up. Because pre his power-up, the reason you had to nerf Bond was because if Bond actually kept up relative to someone like Meliodas in terms of raw power, then you wouldn't have a story. Because outside of the few characters that could, like, soul drain, well, to be fair, a lot of characters could soul drain Bond. The fact that no one did is kind of a, you know, it's the thing that Nakaba, like, wrote around in the story. Like, he was just like, oh, well, Bond can't fight, so of course no one's gonna soul rip him. But honestly, that was one of the main things. Like, Nakaba wanted that mainly for the Molaska and Gallen fight, and then, like, he had to keep Bond out of fights because that was the only weakness he really had. But the thing is, if Bond had kept up as strong as Meliodas or something like that, or even as strong as post-training King, or as strong as post-training Diane, or as strong as post-Infinity Merlin, as strong as any of these actual relevant characters who have moments after the beginning of series, honestly, Bond would have been too broken. Like, legitimately, his toolkit was too strong. And you can tell Nakaba himself agreed for the fact that after the time skip, the moment Bond, well, not time skip, well, I mean, technically it was a Bond time skip, I mean, it's in thousands of years in the hyperbolic time chamber, no, it's purgatory. But the thing is, after the time skip, Bond just never used Snatch again, except for saving Zeldris. And on top of that, he never, well, no, he didn't never use his immortality again. The moment he popped out of Purgatory, the moment he finally got back, the first thing he went and did was go get rid of his immortality, one of his biggest perks. Well, the only thing that even kept him relevant in the mid-series, kinda. Even then, he wasn't that relevant. And of course, we just lose Snatch. And you could argue, well, technically, Snatch wouldn't be effective against characters like the Demon King, because, you know, they have the ruler. And I understand that. But to the point, it almost, this is weird to say, it not devalues Bond's power-up. Because without Bond's power-up, they wouldn't have been able to fight the Demon King Meliodas' body, and everyone would have died. So that was pretty bad. And there's that major fight. And you can also argue, because of Bond's post-purgatory power-up, he was able to stop the Enduras Bond from absolutely ravaging Britannia, forcing the sins to separate to go take care of all of them, and he allowed them to go instantly hop to help that boy Meliodas out because he needed help against the Demon King. So yes, those are two very big things that post-purgatory Bond gets. But I think the thing is, he becomes less interesting the more and more Nakaba took away from him as a fighter. Like, as cool as hyper-concentration was, say that hyper-concentration or super-concentration, hold on, it is in fact super-concentration. As cool as that was, it was not as cool as immortality. As cool as Korchus was, it was not as good as immortality. As cool as Korchus and super concentration were, they were not as cool as Snatch. Like, so many things got ripped away from Bond, them sitting here like, but why though? But at the same time, I completely understand why, because from a narrative perspective, Bond being too strong sort of breaks the narrative. But you want to have Bond to have the finish of his character arc, which is him coming to a full understanding of himself, rekindling his relationship with Elaine, and thus receiving new life, new hope, new power, new everything. However, the thing is, if you were to allow Bond to do that while keeping his full capacities as a warrior, people are done, son, because he's too strong. That's the thing. So Nakaba sort of like forced Bond in this awkward scenario by making him so strong beginning of series, by giving him immortality, Snatch, great usage of Snatch, all these cool abilities on top of that. He sort of ended up nerfing Bond in the long run because he couldn't let Bond be too strong. It's the hard counterbalance of, okay, I need a really strong character, but I can't have this character be as strong as the other strong characters because he's going to break the narrative. And I get it. And that's one of the rare occasions where I say Nakaba is like 100% focused on not necessarily power scaling, but I suppose you could really say power scaling. He was like, well, I can't let Bond keep up because he'll break it. And I get it. But here's the thing. Here's the workaround for it, because I've really just been complaining up to this point. How I would fix Bond's missed potential as a warrior is allow him to use his abilities, the specific ones he has, before the power-up, that means immortality and snatch, let him use them in ways that can benefit the characters who are allowed to be strong. What do I mean? So, in the fight with Roland Glaxinia, this is before everyone gets sealed away, have Meliodas ask Bond, or have Bond do it himself the moment he realizes Meliodas is going on the attack, to start draining Drolan Gluxinia's power. They're both extremely weakened right now, and the more weakened they are, the easier they'll be to kill, and the easier Meliodas' job will be. Bond knows that he can't absorb that much, but him doing anything there rather than just quickly becoming a hostage would have been better. On top of that, have Bond use snatch on weapons. Like, say, well, this happened. This once again comes down to the fact that they get turned to hostages so quickly, but say instead of Meliodas, since he's so focused on Droll, Bond sees Gluxinia going to heal himself with Best Boy Basquiat. And what Bond does is he snatches the droplet of life away. And say he throws it on Meliodas or he throws it on someone else. That's the thing. Have him not be allowed to like fight at proper full capacity, but allow him to keep using his abilities in interesting ways. Because the thing is, since he got hard locked off at Gallen, since he simply wasn't strong enough to maintain all the extra strength he was absorbing, then give him other ways to use his abilities. Let him be a temporary power vessel container. Let him be something that, okay, we know he's going to be taken out of the fight after this, but at least he's able to benefit the cast in some way, shape, or form. Because we get this whole arc of Bond being useless because he's not strong enough, because he himself hasn't come to the full realization of himself as a character, and thus he's not allowed to be as strong as he is. So that makes sense, but that's only on a narrative side of things. And even then, on a narrative side of things, it doesn't make sense for one of the seven deadly sins, one of our main characters, to be so fodder, like more fodder than Gother. And Gother is a character who doesn't really get that much more physically stronger, but what Nakaba does is allow him to use his abilities in situations where his abilities would work. Gother gets to use Invasion all throughout the series, and Invasion doesn't necessarily slow down its usefulness or its potency. Snatch gets snatched away before, way before he runs into any like Demon King or Zeldarus who could just ignore his ability. And even then, he doesn't always have to use the magical aptitude of Snatch. Have him snatch weapons. Like I mentioned Basquiat earlier, but imagine against Chandler. As Chandler's going in for a full counter, suddenly his staff just leaves his hand. It's because Bond used snatch to get it away, and then he gets smacked in the face by a gigantic beam of whatever, or like Chassifol hits him in the face because he no longer has a weapon to use full counter for. Weapons are so important in Seven Deadly Sins, and a great way to have Bond stay useful while he's still weaker is to have him negate that advantage that they provide. Someone like Meliodas couldn't fight without a weapon, or well, no, he could very easily fight, but someone like Meliodas and Chandler can't use full counter without a weapon, without a conduit. So taking away the staff would have been very, very good. Then that's the main issue though. Bond, due to his lack of viability, needs to disappear from the narrative for so long that there aren't many fights he could interfere in. But even then, imagine against something like Estarossa versus Escanor. I know Escanor would definitely not want any help from Bond, but imagine Estarossa swings, reveals full counter, and then Bond is like, wait a minute, if that's exactly like the captain's, as you say, you shouldn't be able to do that if you don't have that weapon. And then, as Estarossa and Escanor are fighting, in order to help Escanor out a bit, bam, the weapon's yanked away. And suddenly it's thrown somewhere far away. But in that moment where Estarossa has turned his back, Escanor swinging on him, like stuff like that, where Bond is sort of supplementing things on top of what he can't do. Like he's making up for his weakness through pure skill or through pure ability usage. And I think that would be cooler for Bond because it allows him to still be useful even if he's not that powerful. Same way that Gother was still useful even though he wasn't that powerful. And I think that's the important thing, to keep a character relevant without fully keeping a character relevant. Because, like I said in the beginning of the video, I love the way that Nakaba took Bond and how he only gets his true EOS strength by the time that he fully understands himself, has gone through an entire spiritual, mental, and physical journey through Purgatory, has traveled with his best friend for so long, and has gone through such tough experiences. It's only then that he achieves his true zenith of his power. But the thing is, by restricting him for so long, by having him be so weak for such a large chunk of the series, like post Meliodas and the gang versus stage one Hendrickson, like Red Demon Hendrickson, the moment Gray Demon Hendrickson pops up, Bond sort of becomes useless. And I know you could argue, well, Gallen versus Bond was also Bond being useful. And yes, Hunter's Festival was very, very good there, but it didn't stop the problem. It stalled it. And to be fair, I guess that's what Bond has to become. If Makaba doesn't want Bond to be the ender anymore, he has to be someone who's allowed to be a staller, be a misdirector, be a thief. Let him do that. One of Bond's biggest things in his nature is that he's a thief. So let him thief weapons. Let him thief little things. Let him misdirect. Like, if he has the ability to stop things in motion, like he stopped Gila's sword, let him stop an attack. Like, while, say, once again, in the fight with Chandler, for reference, Chandler and King, they're going back and forth. They're swanging. They're throwing chassis full. They're throwing grudge blades. And suddenly, instead of Chandler's arm moving the way it wants to, it moves diverted. It distracts him. Boom, he gets smacked in the face with increased spears. Stuff like that. Little misdirections, little manipulations to allow Bond to still stay relevant, so Bond still stays interesting. Alongside the stuff of him not being interested in himself because he's not physically strong enough to help people out in the normal way he would want to help people out. That can still be Bond's arc. Ironically enough, I'm trying to fix the wasted potential without, like, cutting into the arc that Bond's supposed to have as a character, because I really like that arc, but at the same time I don't like what Bond is reduced to, especially after season one when he was so potent, so deadly, so dangerous. To see him get dropped so hard that's why it became a meme. That's why it became a joke. Bond was a whole joke for a whole, like, darn near, let's see, when was Hendrickson defeated? Like, early chapter 100s, if I'm going off the top of the dome. And then Bond doesn't really become relevant till he pops up, and I think around chapter 285. So that's almost 200 chapters of Bond not being useful. And to be fair, once again, Gallant versus Bond was something where he was useful because he got him to Escanor, and Escanor is Escanor. But in terms of, like, actual Bond on his own being a menace and a threat, he wasn't really that much ever since the end of the first arc, and I don't like that. So I'm trying to fix that while keeping his main arc intact. I think by having him use his side ability, his main ability in a very important way, I think that can work. I think that can act as a substitute for a pre-purgatory Bond. For a post-purgatory Bond, this may sound wild, but I don't think he needed to be nerfed. He didn't. Nakaba, I get why you did it, but at the same time, I don't get why you did it, because why did you have to nerf him? Why give up the immortality? I would prefer it if something along the lines of he treated Elaine like a fairy tree. Sure, it'd be awkward, sure, it'd be disgusting, but still, I would love it if Bond, instead of trying to just give up his immortality entirely and then cursing Elaine to a life of loneliness once she finally gets to the end of her road, because reasonably, no matter how young Bond is now, Elaine ain't dying no time soon, especially if she's on that Hardy mentality. She ain't dying no time soon, so she's literally gonna have to watch Bond age and die. So rather than having Bond give up his immortality, either A, do this where he just starts, like, giving her blood treatments or, like, blood transfusions, where he's keeping her alive through the immortality, just like she kept him alive through the Fountain of Youth initially. I feel like that would have been a beautiful wrap-up to their story, where he saved her. Well, no, she saved him, and then he saves her. That perfect balance where they're now just flowing around each other. That would have been more beautiful than Bond giving up his immortality and dying in, like, 80 years. And that's being generous if Bond even lives to 100. So the thing is, once you could either do that, or you could have Bond give up part of his immortality, or, like, he actually shortens his lifespan or something like that, or something. Have an effect where he doesn't get rid of his immortality, because the immortality is one of the coolest things about Bond. And I know it would have made him super buff, but just keep the Demon King super buff. Even the moment that the Demon King had some sort of mental control over Meliodas' body, Bond was kind of getting washed. And I mean, he wasn't necessarily getting washed, but the Demon King had the upper hand. So even a Bond with immortality, he would have been better, of course, because he'd be constantly healing. But I feel like you could have just kept the Demon King super buff, like he was supposed to be. He was the endgame boss before all the Cath and Chaos nonsense. The Demon King was supposed to be the final boss. So having him be super buff against an immortal Bond wouldn't be a problem in my mind. And you can still give Bond core juice. And here's how you still use Snatch. Let Bond be a menace. Let him use Snatch against the Demon King's object like he tried to. Like, in the middle of the Demon King fight, we know that the Demon King himself may be immune to his magic attacks, but his own little constructs aren't. So have Bond, in the middle of the fight, just be like, hold on, buddy. He, like, swings on the Demon King with one hand, and with the other hand, he yanks the Sighing Sage out of the sky to save other people. Let him still use Snatch in an interesting way, even if he can't use it directly on the Demon King. Same thing for the Prime Demon King fight later. Have him pull up, and as the Demon King King goes to swing, he uses Snatch and yanks the sword out of the Demon King's hand. Have him act as a misdirector and an attacker. Let him fuse both his abilities and his power in order to make an ultimate combo. Let him be a full-on fighter. Let him be a full-on warrior that he deserves to be by the end of the series. Let him have a full culmination of understanding everything about his powers and using them in tandem to work himself to the absolute limit. And I think a full immortal bond with Kurochus, with everything, using Snatch, he would be a menace. I'll admit, he would be a menace. He'd be quite the problem, I'll admit. But the thing is, you have characters that could beat him still. True Magic Meliodas could still beat him. Chaos could still beat him. Chaos Arthur could still beat him. Like, there are still characters that would have been above Bond to the point where I don't think nerfing him as hard as you did Nakaba was the smartest thing to do, because it just makes him seem so much more useless in comparison for a majority of the series. And even post time skip, he sort of just becomes a bit more generic when he was one of the most interesting characters to watch before all of that back in the original story. But that's my thoughts. If I'm being completely honest, I would simply let Bond use Snatch more creatively. That's how you fix the missed potential of himself as a warrior, using his abilities properly. Let him use it to steal away weapons. Let him use it to misdirect people, as he's been shown to be able to do. Let him be able to do that, and let him go nuts. Simply just let Bond have fun. Bond's a super fun character. I feel like he deserves more fun moments, and he shouldn't have been relegated to just a side useless character. While, like I said before, and I think I've said this like 5 times writing this video, I'm fine with the arc that Bond went down. I think the arc is beautiful. However, I don't think nerfing him so hard by making him give his immortality and keeping him fully 100,000% useless for a majority of the series was the best idea, especially when every other Sin was getting power-ups or was already super strong. But that's just me. Please tell me what you guys think in the comment section down below. Do you think I'm crazy? Do you think Bond was done just fine? Do you think the solutions I offered are like gonna affect his arc in any way, and you think it'd make you like him less? Do you think it'd make you like him more? Tell me your own ideas on how to save Bond's potential in the comment section down below, if you even think it's a problem. If you don't, just tell me, please. I'd love to hear it in the comment section down below. Thank you guys so much for watching. Please remember to like, share, comment, and subscribe, and I hope you guys have a wonderful day. Also, make sure you hit that little notification bell so you don't miss out on any videos that come to the channel. Thank you guys once again. Hope you guys have a wonderful day, and this is That Guy with the Pencil, writing off.